awareness, the thread connecting all different beings. People go on praying, but awareness never dawns. Nanak uses the word surati for awareness, constant remembrance. Kabir also uses the same word, and Nanak's word is surati for the entire process. Buddha used the word right mindfulness, and Gurdjieff calls this self-remembrance, and Jiddu Krishnamurti calls this as awareness. The matter is very delicate. The word surati is very delicate. Try to understand this with an example. A mother is busy cooking the food at home. Her child is playing nearby. Apparently, all her attention is on cooking. But her awareness or surati or awareness or self-remembrance is in the child. She is aware of the child's presence around. He may not fall, the child may not climb the steps, and so on and so forth. Despite being absorbed in the work of cooking that she is doing, there is a constant remembrance. Constant remembrance of the child. This is what Nanak means by surati. Mother goes to sleep. Even with thunder and lightning, her sleep is not disturbed. However, the child turns a little, the mother wakes up. Even in her sleep, she is aware of the child. There is a remembrance of child even in sleep. This is surati. Surati means constant remembrance, and in spiritual terms, when translated, it means a remembrance of that which is. Surati is like the thread that passes through all the beads of a rosary. You can connect all discarded actions and elements, and yet still allow the remembrance remain like the invisible thread between all the beads. Only one thread passes through individually separate beads. There is no need to run away from the world. Do all that you are required to do as part of the family, society, work, etc. But let a constant remembrance remain deep within. Outwardly, you may be involved in the most mundane work, but deep within there is a remembrance of God. His subtle presence remains like the invisible thread in the mala. There was an incident. At a time, Sufi Brijmohan Lal and his father, Sufi Raghavardayal or Chachaji, were living in the same town, same house. Chachaji has disciples. One of them developed an eye problem. So he went to the nearby, the Muslim doctor, who have their own system, just as Hindus have Ayurveda system, Muslims use a system. So these Ayurveda, the Muslim doctors, they were known as Hakim, and they had the unique way of treatment. When the person went, he looked at his eyes, he was surprised, gave him the medicine, whatsoever it was. The person came home. Next day, another person got a similar problem. He too accompanied the first one, and he too was examined by the doctor, and medicine was given. Third day, another person developed a similar problem. He too accompanied. Now it is the trial. Three of them went. When he saw the third person, he said, "Wait. Now tell me the truth. These eyes seem to be wounded by someone. They seem to be in love." So these people said, "We are old persons." He said, "No, this is not like worldly love. It is the divine love. Your eyes seem to be wounded by a mystic. Tell me the name of the person. I would like to meet where everybody's eyes are made in the same kind of vision." Because when people come in the company of a particular master or sheikh, his energy field surrounds them, his way of life, style, choice of words, all gets changed according to the sheikh. So they were a little bit hesitant. He said, we have the instructions not to release the name of the person." So the doctor said, "You will not give the medicine until you tell me the name of the person." He said, "Tomorrow, when we return, we will inquire from our sheikh if to reveal his identity for you." So the three came home and he mentioned to Chachaji that so and so happened. He said, no, don't tell my name. Tell the name of..." He pointed towards his son, Sufi Brij Mohanlal, tell his name. So they went next day and told the doctor the name and the information about Sheikh Brij Mohanlal. He inquired, "Where does he work?" And so he used to work in police office as head clerk. So the next day, the doctor went to pay a visit to Sufi Brij Mohanlal. And these three were very anxious to know what is the opinion of this person about my master. So in the evening when they visited, they inquired from the doctor, "Did you visit my master?" He said, "Yes, I visited, but I did not meet him." He said, "What does it mean?" He said, "I went, he was busy in his work, and the etiquette says when someone is busy, you do not disturb him. But in our day-to-day life, people mechanically go on wishing good morning, as if a parrot is passing and they have no basic etiquette that someone should pay respect only when the attention of the person is towards you. Otherwise, it is futile." So these people inquired, "And what happened?" He said, "I remained standing behind his chair for 1 hour.
1 hour you remained standing?
"Yes, for 1 hour I remained standing."
"For what?"
You know, normally the question will come. He said he was doing the work of the office so engrossed, it appeared that he will finish the entire work of the office by himself in a day, but not even a single breath was free from the name of the Divine. The kalma, the remembrance, the surati was going on each breath. Not that on this breath you curse this one, next breath you had seen a good looking woman or man, so your attention goes towards that, or you get a nice fragrance in your nostrils, the remembrance goes to that. No, constantly you observe for 1 hour. His awareness has not wavered. It was constantly on, flowing on that which is. It was not wavering at any moment. And he said, I remained standing there for 1 hour, waiting. Maybe there will be a lapse of one breath. And that is when I will pay my respect to him. Now these people's ego got inflated. My master is so great. When he went and he told the master, he said, Lahal Wala Kuvat. Lahal Wala Kuvat is the way, just as in English we say, oh my God, you did not inform me. Now the sheikh has to hammer their ego. Lahal Wala Kuvat. Oh my God, you did not tell me. The man remained standing behind me for 1 hour and I did not pay attention to him. What would he be thinking about me? The unique way of the masters. They do not want the ego, even about their master, that my master is a great one. He had so many disciples and he is such, has such a deep awareness of, he speaks so beautifully. Any question you ask him, he, as if he is the encyclopedia. No, nothing like that. The master wants to go in the heads of his disciples. Then a meeting was arranged between the two, and when two old friends meet, you know, there is a party in the house for the children. They will be sharing their moments. The many delicacies will be prepared. But what will happen when the two persons, the masters, meet? They have nothing to talk, but everything to share in gestures and this and that, and each praising the other. This is a remembrance. Surati means a constant remembrance, is like the thread that passes through all the beads of the rosary. He is doing his work, mundane, turning the office files, because he was the head clerk at the police office. What kind of files will there be? Files of the criminals, files of many kinds. There is no need to run away. Instead, there is no need to leave the world. And if you have attained to Surati, only then you are a seeker. You are then both worldly and spiritual. You are in the world, but the world is not in you. How could that be possible? You are in the world, but you are not in the world. This is known as renunciate. You have not abandoned anything, but your remembrance is on that which is common. This is known as, in Hinduism, the state of self-liberation or Jivan Mukti. Janak wanted to get knowledge. For that he arranged a congregation of the saints and mystics. One of them was 12-year-old boy Ashtavak. This comes from the two words. Asht means eight, Vakra means curves. His body was bent at eight places. You can imagine if a person is hunchback and he is walking, it becomes a source of laughter. And when somebody's body is bent at eight places, what will be this scene? People can naturally begin to laugh seeing him walking. So when in the congregation, Janak said he want to get that awareness during the time when he is riding the horse. In order to ride the horse, you have to keep one foot on the one side of the saddle, then you cross over the other foot onto the next side of the horse and rest on the saddle and then sit down. How long does it take? In a flash of a second, the person should be able to give me the knowledge during that period. When nobody could fulfill that wish of Janak, Ashtavakra, who was present with his mother, she addressed Ashtavakra. He said, "Ashtavakra, these sages are like your father, they are elderly to you. Saluting them, go and fulfill the wish of Janak. He has challenged the entire spiritual community. As he get up, everybody burst into laughter seeing him standing." At this, Ashtavakra said, "Janak, I thought that you was wise, but you have gathered the congregation of cobblers. A cobbler's attention, his awareness is only of the skin. Is my skin important, the color, or my understanding or awareness is important?" Then he told Janak, "Janak, go and ride the horse." As Janak put his one foot on the one side of the saddle and was ready to cross over to the other side, he said, "Janak, this I have narrated in many ways to give him the awareness that how can you be in the world and be not of the world, and then how to empty the mind. I will give the two versions. The first, how can you be in the world and not be in the world?" As Janak had his one foot on the saddle, without that you cannot ride the horse. You put your one foot on the saddle, which is about 2 feet, depending on the height of the horse, 2 feet, 3 feet, and you take a jump, cross over the leg, the other leg, over to the next side. As he was about to do, he said, "Janak, stay as you are." Now his one foot is hanging in the air, holding the reins of the horses. Imagine the situation, and one foot on the side of the saddle. He said, "Janak, tell me, are you on the ground or on the horse?" Janak did not know what to say. He said, "In a way I am on the ground, because horse is standing on the ground. And in a way I am not on the ground, because my foot is not on the ground. In a way I am on the ground, but in a way I am not. In a way I am on the horse, but in a way I am not on the horse." He said, "This is the state of renunciate. He is in the world, but he is not in the world. His one foot is 3 feet above the ground, so he is not on the ground virtually. And he is on the ground because of the gravitational force of the earth, and the horse, all the 4 feet are grounded. His next feet is in the air. So if you have a constant remembrance, you can be in the world and you are not." When Janak, as the Janak, now the second version, as he was ready to cross over to the other side, he said, "Janak, stay as you are. You have taken such an intense vow at which the life of the mystics were at stake. His promise was, if someone does not get him enlightened between the dawn and dusk, the person will be slain. And what is the offering, the Guru Dakshina? What do you want to give to your master? He said, anything that you ask, my kingdom and everything, my family, anything that you want. He said, give me anything that is yours. He said, my kingdom is for you. He said, does this kingdom really belong to you? If something belongs to you, that means it belonged to you earlier. It is yours now and it will be yours afterwards also. Did this kingdom belong to you before you were born? He said, no. I had inherited from my father and my father had inherited from his father and so on and so forth. He said, what will happen after you? He said, my children will inherit that. He said, then how can that you call as yours? That which does not stand on all the aspects of time, how can that be yours? Chanak got into a state of trance. He did not know. He said, look deep within. Search. Is there anything that is really yours? Janak looked into. He said, Master, my mind is the only thing which is mine. I give that to you. Now, as Janak made the promise to give his mind to the Master, Master said, Janak, this mind is mine. You cannot use it for your purpose. Anytime any thought appeared in his mind, Ashtavakra will caution, Janak, that mind is no more yours. This is mine. You cannot use my things. You have given this watch to me. Now you cannot use it. This is simple. But the thought of the watch will come again and again in you. You will say, let me just have a look at it the last time. But mind is something different. And Janak got into a state of trance. He was ready to fall. Ashtavakra held on to him and he became enlightened. This is remembrance. You are doing everything, but there is a constant remembrance. A man was sent. There are so many stories, I can go on and on. A man came to Janak, he was sent. He heard that Janak is in the world, but he is a renunciate. He wondered, how can this person be a renunciate? He is a king and a kingly splendor and all kinds of things. When he came to Janak to inquire and learned from him, he found that he himself seemed to be lost. What can I learn from him? Janak said, I am busy right now with the work of the kingdom. Certainly I would like you to stay and you take this lamp. I would like you to go and visit my palace in the kingdom. Because the palaces of the kings were very big and spread in a larger area. He said that the palace is under construction and there is no light as yet. So you have to carry this lighted lamp with you. But you remember that the walls are not there on the either side and the breeze blows. So you have to make sure that this lamp does not extinguish. And without the lamp, you will not be able to see the structure, the buildings, the architect, and so on and so forth. He took the lamp, and as he was told, he visited the whole palace. admired the buildings and everything. He returned, and by that time Janak had finished his work. So he inquired, "Did you visit the palace?" He said, "Yes, it's a beautiful palace." He said, "Did you look at everything?" He said, "Yes, I looked at everything." Then Janak said, "Where your attention was?" The man, Sannyasi, said, "My attention was on the lamp that with the breeze it does not turn off, it does not extinguish. So I kept my two hands on the either side, protecting it from the breeze blowing and blew it out." He said, "In the same way is my life. I am involved in day-to-day work, but my attention is on that which is the common thread. Every moment there is a constant remembrance. The seeker is like a pregnant woman. A change has taken place within her biology. And with that change, her awareness has changed. There is a constant remembrance that she is carrying a baby in her womb. She does everything. She even makes love. She bends down, but every moment there is a constant remembrance that she is carrying a new life within the womb. She is nourishing and nurturing that. You are nourishing, you are now pregnant. The master had made you pregnant. Don't take it literally. The master had made you pregnant. Something is taking place within your innerness, and with that, something is growing deep within your consciousness. You have to put your total attention on that. Not even a single lapse of a moment has to be there. This is remembrance, this is awareness. Outwardly, you may be involved in most mundane work, but deep within there is a remembrance of God. A subtle presence remains like an invisible thread of the rosary. There is no need to leave the world. This is meant by being in the world and not be affected by the world. My work involves is most mundane, dealing with the customers. When I have to go and make a delivery in a particular area, I have to consider many factors. Number one, the person who has ordered this particular item is dependent on me. Sometimes a person will ask for something which is $30. Now, $30, that is the selling price. It incorporates the cost and the profit. So, according to economics, there is a break-even cost. If I go to deliver a particular item, whether it is $1 or $100, my cost of operation will remain the same. The wear and tear, the vehicle, my time. But there is a greater factor that the person is dependent on me for that. So I have to think of all these factors, whether it is economical for me to deliver this item to that person, does it cover all the economic, fulfill all the economic criteria? The break-even cost. In the $30 item, maybe my profit is $5, but my cost of operation is $20. So that means I am at a loss of $15. Although I gained $30 covered, collected $30, but $15 is my cost of operation and $5 is the profit. So this is a loss. Amidst all these factors, there remains a common denominator that this person depends on me. He needs this item. Dealing with mundane things on a day-to-day basis. Yet still the remembrance, and on the way I am going, connected 24/7 to that invisible current, all of a sudden I pull the car on the shoulder, write something and post it on the social media network, gone on the highway again and reached the destination. This is remorse. People go on doing prayers, but they never attain to surati, never attain to awareness. From morning till evening, they are holding the rosary in their hands. The stream merges in the river merges in the ocean, but river never knows the ocean. Just dropping or merging in the ocean of divinity is not enough to know the ocean. So too, every finite moment, like a river, you are falling in God, the ocean. But there is no awareness. Each birth happens out of Him. And with each death, you dissolve into that which is the existence. However, there is no awareness. You are like the stream, the pond, the river that falls in the ocean at the end of life's journey. This is happening unconsciously. Your life is like a sleepwalker. Rivers and streams still remain unknown and helpless. They know not what has happened. But you have the opportunity. With each incoming breath, you evolve out of that harmony. And then with each outgoing breath, once again you emerge, you merge with the harmony, the cosmic harmony. Your breath has gone out, birth has come, you have gone away from that cosmic harmony. And when breath goes out, you have merged with that harmony. The moment your breath goes out, it becomes cosmic because it has gone out. It is part of a cosmic harmony where all individual breaths merge. All discordant breaths of Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Jews and all nationalities merge into this cosmic harmony. You release your breath into the cosmos. Your friend, your enemy, everyone does so. And then from there comes in your incoming breath. But you remain unaware and unconscious of this. With each breath, God, a cosmic harmony or oneness comes in. And with each outgoing breath, the same happens and goes out. In each breath He is there. With this awareness that comes in, there is no end to your joy or bliss. The orchestra is mute, yet still a blissful melody flows like an undercurrent. Only then you are filled with gratitude that for the first time, the theism is born into you. By prayer, one does not become a theist. It is the awareness that makes you a theist, a devotee. Even an ant or an oyster that remembers him is far better than even an emperor who possesses a mountain of wealth. Even the poor who has attained to awareness becomes the richest, and even an emperor remains the poor without awareness. There is only one way to poverty, and that is forgetting God. So too, there is only one way to be rich, and that is going the way of awareness of Subhati. Nanak says the only way to richness is his remembrance, and the only way to poverty is his forgetfulness. All your money, name and fame will not matter. It is said when Alexander died, he had asked to keep his two hands outside so that people can learn the message that even an Alexander could not carry anything from this world with him. What is Nanak? He had no wealth, no status, no kingdom. He is not head of any institution. He is not the head of Sikh organization. The only thing Nanak has is his constant remembrance of Subhati. And with this, many a learned kings, emperors all fade like the stars in the presence of the sun. In front of Nanak, all is useless. You are like the children who go on collecting pebbles and consider them as precious. Secretly, they bring inside the house and keep in safe custody. And very so often, the mother has to remove these pebbles from the safe custody to keep the place clean. The same child will grow one day, and then he will not gather the same pebbles that were once precious for him. Instead, he will ask his children to throw these pebbles because they are useless. But to a child, these are precious, and he goes on collecting and preserving them. Whenever you accumulate in the world, remains valuable until awareness of Subhati is not there. As soon as awareness rises in you, you have attained maturity. A lamp is lit. You are a light unto yourself. When the monks asked Buddha the last time, what is your last message? He said, my life had been the message. But then he said, the last sentence which is very important, Appo Deepo Bhav, be a light unto yourself. In the light of that awareness of Surati, you will realize the futility of all that you have accumulated in life. And consider as your treasure. It is given to you. The vehicle is given to you to use. Maybe you have purchased it by the grace of God alone. By the grace of that which is. You have all the comforts. It's also by the grace. Not through your own efforts. In that light, you will realize the futility of all relations. You are playing. You are a part of cosmic play, a stage show, a TV serial. As soon as the awareness dawns, you are resurrected. A revolution happens. There is a 180 degree change in your life. All that was old dies, new is born. Religion is the search for that which is new. Nanak, you meditate over this. Meditate if there is any small corner within or a temple where awareness echoes as temple echo. As this thought deepens in you, one day you will become. You will come to know the way of awareness. As this thought goes deeper and deeper at the heart center, it will create a groove. And out of this impression evolves awareness. Constantly you are going. Moment to moment, then groove begins to happen in your consciousness. Impressions are being created and your life moves in a different way. The road that pulls water from the well rubs constantly on the edge of the well and thus constantly creates an impression. So too, if the rope of awareness goes on creating impressions in your heart center, one day awareness or surati is born into you. Kabir says, Rasvi avat jat hai, silpar palat nisan. Constantly the rope is rubbing the edge of the wall of the well, and impressions are being created in that. If your life moves like this, awareness will dawn, and then one day you are established in awareness.